Good morning. It is so wonderful to be here in this space with you, whether you're right here in the sanctuary or you are online, wherever you may be, you are welcome here. This is First Congregational Church of Memphis, Tennessee, and we are a community that is committed to making peace in all places. We are a community that is committed to undoing racism in all of its forms. And we are a community that is committed to affirming love in its every expression and orientation. And it's good that we're here together.
Please stand for the call to worship. This morning we gather in the presence of the God called love.
God sees us just as we are, and has our
heart. We sing and we praise, we lament and we mourn. This God makes all things new each day and in every moment. This morning, then, as we gather amidst this holy presence, amen.
Thank you.
The scripture reading this morning is from Jeremiah chapter 31, verses 31 through 34. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant that I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, a covenant that they broke, though I was their spouse, says the Lord. But this is the covenant I will make with the house of Israel after those days. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No longer shall they teach one another or say to each other, "Know God," for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity and remember their sin no more.
Well, I woke up one morning, the rain was falling down, and heard my parents say to each other, "Let's call in John Henry Brown. Walk on, boys. Come on up here. Walk on, boys. Walk on down the line." I gotta get a chair. "Ain't nobody in this whole wide world's gonna help you carry your load. Walk on, boys." Good morning. Good morning. Oh, that's nice. Usually there's nobody here on the holidays. You know, we get to talk about all the holidays because we're the first Sunday of the month. We're Communion Sunday, too. It's an awesome responsibility. We have to talk about all these things. So today, it's Labor Day. Please join us. Make yourselves at home. Well, it's Labor Day weekend, so everybody's kind of taking all this statute. But you're exactly right. It is, because it's a law or something they voted in a long time ago. It's a pretty grown-up concept and everything, but we should chat about it. It started in the 1800s. Some of our bulletin is catching us up on that beautiful theories today that we decided that 8 hours a day was a very decent set of time, that we shouldn't work more than 8 hours a day, and they wanted to focus on workers and spotlight them. So they started a fair day of work idea. Now, John Henry was a folk hero. He's from our song this morning, and he was a guy that made hulls and rocks to blow up explosives to make railroads. That's what he did all day, was he did a schooner, because there's always somebody doing stuff for us all day long, somewhere, somehow. And lots of times people speak to that as workers or laborers or whatever. One of my favorite words comes into our idea this morning, sustainable, sustainability. That's a beautiful word about things. And we can figure out the balance of things. We can not run out of stuff, and we can protect what we have. We decide what our well-being is. We decide what works for us and what's okay, and we stick to it. We work towards it. I love this word. Sometimes you hear the word unions. You ever heard the word unions before? Talking about unions. Well, they make these collective groups of people. What do you think the biggest union in the United States is? What's the largest union that we have? It's the teachers. I mean, it's the Education Association. Powerful, very strong, mighty people. That's our biggest union. The bottom line is, this is what's important. This is what I got out of thinking about this week, is that we need to give more than we take. That was a phrase that I learned when I was thinking about all the sustainability stuff and about our situation with labor and workers and the way we do our relationship with stuff. You have this relationship of people giving pay for equal work and stuff, but then there's these people that want to profit from what's left over from that, and that's not so sustainable. Now, that's all weird, but it's just something I wanted you to hear this morning. So, bottom line is, what is it? We need to give more than we take. So think about that. Now, this is the last Sunday of Easter. That's the last Sunday of the season of Easter. You know how I love seasons. We've got a brand new season coming up. And guess what? Miss Marcia is going to come up here and talk to us about the exciting new season that's coming on, the season of creation, which is one of my favorite too. Here she comes now. There she is. This is good. Let's listen up what she has to say.
I'm going to talk to the grown-ups before we walk out. Then mostly I get to talk to children. I'm Miss Marcia, for those of you who don't know me. The Children's Church has finished a summer of wonder, and we're starting on a fall of flexibility. So in Children's Church, the first Sunday of most months is Yoga Sunday. So today we will think about our flexible bodies. We'll have some lessons in the next couple of weeks on flexible feelings. We'll work on nurturing flexible spirits. Then in October, we'll start thinking about what it means to be a member of a flexible community that welcomes strangers and loves diversity and that gracefully and flexibly moves into new leadership. So that's what we're going to do in the fall of flexibility. Usually I post on Friday afternoons to let parents and families and people who love these little people know what we're going to do on Sunday. If you're not a part, if you're not getting those posts, if you just put it in your yellow sheets, in your bulletin, we'll see if you can get you, if you would like to find out every Friday what we're going to be doing on Sunday. And sometimes on Monday, if I get good pictures, I post again and show you what the children did during the children's church time. Pamela McFarland makes these designs, these beautiful bulletins that the grown-ups have. She also amazingly designs an order of worship for our children. They're beautiful, and we have them every week. And yeah, they really are wonderful. If your children bring them home, I hope you will look through them with your children. There's always a question of the week, and maybe your family would like to discuss that question during the week. But I hope you will look over these bulletins that are so wonderful. And now I think we're ready to march on out. Are we gonna march?
Our marching song. Here we go.
Good morning. I'm Julia Hicks. I'm on staff here at First Congregational Church. But before I welcome our newcomers, I'm going to do a quick correction of Mr. Keith, if you're wondering. This isn't the end of the Easter season. It's the end of Pentecost. And so if you're thinking, Easter, way, that was way back. You're good. Now let's do what I really like to do. In fact, it's my favorite thing to do all week long, and that is to welcome those of you that are here this Sunday and you haven't been here before. You know who you are, of course. We kind of don't know who you are unless we've been kind of scanning around and looking for faces that we don't know. But we want to know you. We want to know you are here. And most of all, we want to make sure that you get any information you need to let you get more involved, to let us know that you're here, to ask questions, to meet our pastors, things like that. And so what I'm going to ask you new folks to do, Marcia referred to it just a few minutes ago, is these yellow sheets are always in our bulletins, and if you would let us know, I'm new today, my name is this, and I hope what you'll do is put your email address down there and say, I'd like to start receiving the newsletters. That way you'll get information, you know, each week. A couple of times, actually, each week you may get some newsletter information to keep you abreast of what's going on in the church. And those of you that are online up there with Rick Mayfield, you can also do this. If you go to your chat, I think Betsy Howard's on there, and she's going to put a link for you to let us know if you're new or if there's anything you need. And those of you that are here, if you don't have a pen or pencil, there's also a QR link in your bulletin. So please walk through that a little bit. If today you don't feel really up to doing, giving us your name or anything like that, that's okay. We hope that you'll just have such a wonderful experience that you'll be back next week or the next week, and you really will let us know that you're here and you'll be ready to start to get to know us a little bit better. While I'm talking about Rick, I'm up there in our computer station that broadcasts out there to the world. I want to bring our attention to someone we love very much, and that's Gail Kuske. And Gail is in Boise, Idaho. She's been there for several months because she is struggling through some really serious cancer treatments. But I heard this morning from Carol that it's going really very well. And so what I've asked Rick to do is to pan out from that center camera right there, and if we will all just turn to that camera and give Gail a wave and say, we miss you, Gail, we love you, get well soon. Yes, and thank you guys for that, because we've all been on the other side of that, and it's fun to get that. Let's see if there was anything else. She says that she misses her church very much and wants to thank you for all the prayers that are coming, and keep them coming. All right, let's look at the back page of our bulletin. That's where your announcements for this coming week are. There's one cancellation tomorrow, and that is the yoga class that normally happens here in the sanctuary on Monday nights is not going to be happening on Labor Day. Let's see. Today, after church, a couple of things, okay? So listen closely if you can. Pastor Tony is going to be leading us in the beginning stages of changing out our artwork from the Easter artwork to the season of creation. Did I say Easter? Wow. Okay, that's like really embarrassing. Thank you. Because I did that to Keith. Easter. Okay. Yes, he's changing us out from Pentecost to the season of creation. Those of you that have been involved in the art ministries, you know who you are. You know if you've already been told this and you're planning to stay to help out. But it's also an opportunity for those of you that have not been part of changing out the art to stay a little bit after church today, kind of see how it's done. Maybe an extra hand or two would be helpful. And also, it may be going on. This is our first change out since our minister of art is not on our staff anymore, and so we're doing it ourselves, and it might be going on a little bit later in the week. So if you can stay, check in with Tony, watch, be available if you can, that'd be super. Now, I'm also going to ask for a couple of people. I don't need you for as long. I need 10 minutes most. There's a couple of pieces of furniture up in some, we've got a new shared space partner coming, and this is Love Doesn't Hurt. It's a wonderful program for trans folks and services for trans folks, and they're moving into their office this week, and I've got a couple of pieces of furniture I need to get out of there, and I can't do it myself. So if you could meet me at the side door there right after church, if you can. If I don't get enough folks, we'll get it done during the week, so don't feel bad about it. But if you can do that, please meet me by the door and help me move a few things. Let's see, Good Books, Good Friends is happening tonight, so if you're a part of that, do that. Did I see Cindy? Cindy, are y'all going to make an announcement about this week's Food Justice? If you are, walk up. If I don't see you, you're not. Okay, come on up. Oh, Cindy's with the children. Thank you. Joy, come on up. Oh, that's great. Trivia. Don't worry about that. Okay.
Ready?
Yeah.
This is Drew, and I'm Joy. We're going to be asking the questions at Trivia next Saturday, September 9th. This is your last announcement about Trivia. You can sign up at the table in the back. Drew and I will be there. If you're making it a date night and you want to bring the children, let us know, because we do have childcare available. And the other thing is park in the back parking lot, and then you'll see a sign on the ramp going down to the fellowship hall, because that's where it's going to be held. And Drew and I are going to know answers, but we cannot be bribed. So just keep that in mind. Is there anything else I have to mention? Okay. Hope to see some people there. Bye-bye.
Thank you, guys. Thank you. And there's more information coming out in your newsletter this week, so it'll where you can sign up and all of that. A reminder that because next Sunday is the beginning of creation, season of creation, it's our pet blessing. And those of you that have pets that you would like to bring to church with you on that one very special day of the year, you may. Please put them on leashes. Please, you might even bring a little water or something if they're going to need it. Or do we provide the water? We'll provide the water. Okay, we'll provide the water for your pets. But anyway, just feel free to bring them, and it's just really a joyous time for our church. Pan, you had an announcement to make.
Okay, I don't know if I can recover from the scent that's overwhelming me here of basil. We have gobs of basil out in the square foot gardens that we've done. And so we have decided to do something very fun with it. September 13th, the next Dove, from 6 to 7:30. But instead of the art room, it's going to be down in the kitchen. And Rev Tony is making dough for pizza. Who likes pizza? Who likes pesto? So we are having a pizza pesto party on September 13th. And this is open to everybody. Y'all please come. It's fun.
Hi, everybody. I just want to let you guys know that I'm taking the final orders for T-shirts, both designs. So if you want one today, you can certainly let me know. Also for the Cooper Young Festival, I'm gonna sell coffee mugs. And we have this coffee mug. It has a painting that was done by a guy originally from Memphis. He lives in New York now. He's an African-American artist named Chris Weary. And so there's a picture of a unicorn on the mug, and then on the back it says, "First Congo, the unicorn of churches." So we are going to be selling these at the Cooper Young Fest for either $12 for one or two cups for $20. But I do have some mugs today if you want to buy some.
All right, I'm still getting over that Easter mistake. Are there any other announcements I'm forgetting this morning? Let's continue our worship with our anthem.
Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Tony Coleman, and I currently serve as associate pastor here. This morning, I want to invite you to think with me about what happens when the very thing that feels like it's sustaining our present is in fact the very thing that's stifling our future. Imagine a child's drawing of the inside of a traditional English church, starts a recent article. There will be colorful stained glass windows and altar, and almost certainly rows of sturdy wooden pews. Yet, the sad truth is, writer and British theater critic Fiona Mountford goes on, that in parish after parish, church after church, the pews, which are often centuries old, she adds, are being removed and replaced by grimly functional chairs of the sort to be found in any meeting hall or conference center. The result, Miss Mountford contends, a cross between a nursery and a Starbucks. Children can run about and coffee can be sold. God, if he manages to get a look in at all, will be present in the form of some irksome tinny religious muzak. Now, if you're like me, when you hear the complaints of someone like Miss Mountford, your first thought might be, so what? What's so bad about children running about and coffee being sold? What's so wrong with God suffusing the air in a room, rather than being painted and posted and name-dropped on every one of its visible surfaces? What's so wrong with chairs? Well, Miss Mountford would answer, the glory of pews. The glory of pews is the feeling they afford of being alone in company. You can contemplate the complexities of life and faith in your own little bubble of solitude before turning to your neighbor further along the row with a friendly smile. At my church, she goes on, everyone used to gravitate each week to their customary spot in their preferred pew, enjoying precious personal space, as well as the companionship of those around them. Newcomers were welcomed and settled easily and happily into this pattern. Mobile phones and other distractions remained out of sight. Peace and stillness, such rare commodities in modern life, reigned supreme. It's not hard to see the beauty in this image. A well-ordered assembly of centuries-old wooden, properly spacing pews so that people can contemplate complexity, so that people could root down into their very souls peace and stillness. It sounds beautiful in a way. The problem is, though, more often than not, people aren't going to church these days to contemplate complexity. We're trying to escape it. More often than not, rather than looking for a temple of peace and stillness, folks are looking for a place that helps them hold the realities of war, both abroad and here. Miss Mountford conjures an image of an old church building that is only half filled on any given Sunday, where people can spread out in long rows and smile at each other rather than hug or hold hands. It's an image that offers comfort and consolation to her and, in fact, many other people. There's an idea out there that churches are places that conserve tradition and preserve piety. It's an image that says that every aspect of a congregation's life needs serve this goal, from the hymns we sing to the theologies we proffer to the very architecture inside our walls. And so, when some folks look at the trends in church attendance, when some folks see that fewer and fewer people every year even consider themselves Christian, let alone attend church, when some folks reckon with the modern day crisis in the Jesus movement, they double down on what they know. They lobby for congregations to reprise the old songs that people used to love. They argue that thousands of dollars get raised and spent on preserving centuries old glass They rail against the idea that a sanctuary should do anything other than be a once-a-week place of repose and contemplation. But if you're here this morning, chances are you probably aren't all that attached to that idea of church. If you're here this morning, chances are you're probably okay with children running about and selling things in the sanctuary. Remember, the mugs are $12 in the back if you need one. Now, differing ideas of church aside, though, we all know what it's like to be in the midst of a crisis and to feel the pull of what's familiar. Regardless of our views of what church is, we all know what it's like to be in the throes of a change we didn't choose and to tighten our grip on familiar routines and rhythms and response. It's a human impulse, really, though the routines differ based on personalities. When we hit a plateau in our careers, some of us will think, I need to work harder, while others of us will think, I need to get out of here. When we hit a rut in a relationship, some of us will think, I need to distance, and others of us will think, I need to dig in. When things start falling apart and uncertainty starts to take hold, each of us has some rhythm, some routine that we consult. What do we do, though, when the very routine that's sustained us up to now is holding us back from where we need to go next? This was the question that the prophet Jeremiah was trying desperately to help the Israelites answer. At the time that he was preaching in Jerusalem, the kingdom of Judah was in a relatively stable place. There was no great famine or apparent crisis pulling the Israelites' attention away from the ins and outs of their daily lives. However, around the outskirts of the city, in this outpost or in that one, the Israelites were battling the armies of the Babylonian Empire. A quiet crisis, in other words, was taking hold of their country as conflicts deepened and grew. Still, the powers that be didn't want people alarmed. They encouraged the prophets of the court and those out in the community to just keep the peace. Jeremiah, however, he wasn't having it. He was preaching about imminent destruction, while his prophesying colleagues painted a happy picture of harmony between God and the Israelites. Jeremiah said things like, "Listen, people. The Lord says, why do you bring me offerings of incense from the land of Sheba? Why do you bring me sweet-smelling cane from far away? Your burnt offerings will not be accepted. Your sacrifices do not please me. This is what the Lord says," Jeremiah goes on. "I will put problems in front of Judah. Fathers and sons, mothers and daughters will stumble over them together. Neighbors and friends will die." Despite the fact that the king and his court wanted things to keep seeming good, despite the fact that the other prophets were getting much cheerier messages from God, despite the fact that the powerful wanted people to maintain their routines and keep up their rhythms, Jeremiah kept on preaching imminent destruction, war, and famine. And two, Jeremiah was saying that what the Israelites thought was working, what they thought was keeping crisis at bay, what they thought would help see them through this uncertain time, well, it wouldn't. While the kings kept saying, "Yes, everything will be okay, just stick to what you know," Jeremiah kept saying, "Stop kidding yourselves. God has told me that you need to stop. God has told me," Jeremiah said, "that not only will what you are doing not save you, but in fact, it's preventing you from preparing for what lies ahead. The days are coming, declares the Lord, according to Jeremiah, when God will make a new covenant with the people of Israel and with the people of Judah. It will not be like the covenant she made with their ancestors when God took them by the hand to lead them out of Egypt. This new covenant will not rely on burnt offerings or public prayers, Jeremiah was saying. This new covenant will not look like the routines and the rhythms you're used to performing. This new covenant, he told the Israelites, is one designed to help you get through the destruction ahead. It will help you learn how to live through the coming crisis in a new way. And as it happened, despite the fact that the kings didn't want to hear him, despite the fact that the prophets disagreed with him, despite the fact that the powerful of his time tossed Jeremiah into a pit, hoping that he would starve to death and just go away, despite the fact that everyone wanted to maintain their typical rhythms and routines as they rested certain that Jeremiah was wrong, Jerusalem did in fact fall. The Temple of Solomon did in fact burn. And the world did, in fact, change. The covenant Jeremiah preached about, the covenant God described through Jeremiah, saying, I will put my law in the Israelites' minds and write it on their hearts. That covenant was designed for a people in exile, a people who could not visit their familiar temples and burn their favorite offerings. Jeremiah was proclaiming that the rhythms and routines of his people were woefully inadequate for the crisis he knew was at work. Jeremiah was trying to tell his people that they needed to break out of their comfort zones and typical ways of being so that they could embrace the new reality God was preparing them to encounter. If any one of us looks long enough and hard enough at our own lives, we'll find one place or two, at least, where God is inviting us to let go of our typical way of being. At any given moment, there's some wall we keep bumping into. There's some pattern we keep repeating, some routine we keep reaching for when things get hard, some rhythm that's just plain old out of sync with reality. If we look hard enough, each of us will find some comfortable habit that is woefully inadequate for the reality we're heading toward. And in our more honest moments, we know it. In our quieter times of prayer or reflection, or in our more frustrated times of trying to figure out why things just won't get right, almost all of us have heard the voice of our very own Jeremiah. The thing about it is, though, none of us ever really wants to listen to that Jeremiah. None of us really wants to reckon with the inconvenient truths, the prophets, the parts of ourselves that are shouting that we need to find a new way to be. None of us wants to listen to that voice that tells us to apologize after we've gotten into a tiff with a loved one. We'd rather stay in the routine of our own righteous anger. More often than not, we don't want to heed the call of the voice that tells us to go to that AA meeting. We'd rather rest in the rhythm of our chosen coping mechanism. We don't want to answer the call to speak up when we're used to keeping quiet. We don't want to imagine a different life when we're so used to trying to figure out how to stay put in this one. We don't want to muster the courage to keep trying when we spent so many years justifying when it's time to give up. We don't want to give up our car or change our eating habits when we've spent so much time just giving money to environmental causes. We all hear the voices of the Jeremiahs, but we'd rather just find some hole to stick them in. What the Jeremiahs are also always saying, though, what these inconvenient truths are always telling us, what these prophetic places in us are always pushing us toward, though, is new life, is possibility. When we let go of the tired routines and rhythms, when we clear out the obstacles to our own imaginations, when we let go of the pews and push beyond our attachments, when we endeavor to do new things and establish new ways, then new things can happen. New seeds can take root. New realities can find space. New sanctuaries can be built, and God can work new covenants. So, I ask you, what's Jeremiah inviting you to let go of right now? What new reality might be trying to take root in your life today? What new future is waiting on the other side of your old routine? God's ready to show you if you're ready to see. Amen. We now worship God as we present our offerings.
Good morning, First Congo. I just want to take a quick moment to thank Jason Eschofen of Theater Memphis. He's here sitting in for Nathan. We appreciate him. And also a thank you. You will hear from Kaya Smith a little later in service for our communion moment. So we thank her and her mom for being here with us today. Thank you.
Good morning.
Keep fighting voices in my mind, say I'm not enough. Every single lie that tells me I would never measure up. Am I more than just the sum of
I'm not afraid to die. nice hand. And let's join together in the affirmation of community. We will be together. We will stand as brothers and sisters given life by one God. We will be together. We will watch out for one another. We will listen to what needs to be said in a spirit of compassion. We will wait for the slowest, fastest. We will dry the tears of those who are weeping and know that they will dry ours when the time comes. We will let ourselves begin to feel at least a little of the pain of those we have considered our enemies. We will entrust our stories to each other. We will not be skeptical that peace can come. We will not forget the joy of life. We will not forget to be grateful. We will do our best to stir in each other hope, courage, and faith. You can be seated. Let us pray. We gather here this morning, O God, in a spirit of love and welcome, to share who we are, to be open to new insight, and to seek all that speaks truth to our hearts and beings. Enable us to rejoice in the beauty of the earth, to be inspired by the wonders of the world, and to tune into your ancient message of love. Let us counter the forces of anger and anxiety and despair by commanding ourselves to your guidance and mercy and the reality of your grace. We pray for all who suffer or struggle. Help us to respond with empathy and goodwill and to find ways to offer healing. We pray especially this day for Edwina, for Gail, for Anne, for Chuck, for Jeff, for all who grieve, for those who struggle to regain trust in their marriage, and for those trying to find financial stability. We remember those who live in violence, and we pray for justice in our government at all levels, for police, so that they may protect and uphold our best principles as a city, for all who seek positive change among us. We remember those who are recovering from storm, from flood, from hurricane, especially from the devastation of Hurricane Idalia. We pray for families separated and traumatized at our southern border, and for those struggling with the violence of the war in Ukraine. We lift these concerns and all the concerns of our hearts to you. Thank you.
you help me celebrate communion? We celebrate this sharing of bread and cup, remembering that Jesus' ministry took place around tables. Tables where the unwelcome were invited in. Tables where the powerful were taught and humbled. Tables where the hungry were fed and the thirsty were given something to drink. In these meals, God's presence was revealed and made real, and a new form of community was born. This table, to meet Jesus and to experience the power of God. We give thanks for our lives molded from the earth itself and destined to return to this earth, which sustains us in every moment from birth to death. We ask that you help us to appreciate the beauty of this place, to respect the integrity of the ground upon which we stand. We ask that you help us to appreciate this table and its gifts, for it is here that we are gathered, filled with good things to eat, and sent into your world to proclaim grace, life, and peace. We remember Jesus. On the night in which Jesus was betrayed, he sat at supper with his disciples. While they were eating, he took a piece of bread, blessed it, and broke it. He gave it to them, saying, "This is my body. It is broken for you. Do this to remember me." And then he took a cup of wine, saying, "This cup is God's new covenant. Drink it." This table is open to all people of faith and those of doubt. I now invite the servers to come up and join me. Please come forward.
Come.
Will you join me in our covenant prayer? We covenant with the Lord and one with another, and do bind ourselves in the presence of God to walk together in all his ways, according as he is pleased to reveal himself unto us in his blessed word of truth. Friends, let us go forth into the new week ready to do new things. Amen. Let's join now in singing, "And Again I Say Rejoice."
That was a sudden stop.